Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We have gathered here this morning to pay our final respects to our beloved Yvonne O'Neill, who's been mother and sister-in-law to me and others, grandmother, you know, and dearly beloved to very many of us. Unfortunately, at this time, because of the COVID situation, there's a few of us are able to be here at this particular time. But I think that we bring the love of all the others who knew her in her lifetime. We bring their love with us, and so we really, few in number, but we are full in terms of our love and appreciation for her, the life that she lived and the way she touched all of us. With faith in Jesus Christ, we received the body of our sister Yvonne for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God, our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Yvonne. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on this our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console all who mourn. Especially give us faith that we might see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those like Yvonne who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, we receive the body of our sister Yvonne in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Anyone who believes in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. We brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. So we pray the collect for the dead. Almighty God, we remember today your servant Yvonne, and we pray that having opened to her the gates of a larger life, you will receive her more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, she may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, O Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Now we have the readings. You will do those.
Yeah.
You'll do it that way instead of having. Right. So Russell will do a series of readings that will link up with Ashutia. This is the main.
Okay. Hello, good morning. Good morning, family. So I'm Yvonne's son, one of her sons, one of the three sons and the three remaining children. Just quickly, I know that normally we would want to do some sort of eulogy and remembrances and whatnot. What is really impacting in my heart is that what I know, I really know very surely in my heart, that mom wants to say to her family. And we know how much she loved her family very deeply, in particular her brothers and sisters. So in saying that, I know mom, she's now glorified. She is with Christ, with the saints, all those who had gone before, as Anderson just mentioned, she's glorified. And she wants us all to join her. So what is in my heart is that she wants the word and the truth to really come from her to those she loves. And the truth is in our scripture, in our Bible. All of our family, I don't think any of us are Hindus, And I'm not sure if any of us are atheists that totally rejects that God exists. So I'm saying that the only source for truth for us who believe, who really have professed that we want to follow Jesus, is the Bible. So I'm going to read verses. I'm not going to preach. That's the extent of my preaching for the morning. I'm just going to read some verses from the Bible, which is truth. And I'm going to start with John 3, 14 to 17. And included in there is, of course, everybody knows John 3, 16. So let me just pull up the reference in the Bible. And as I said, it starts from 14, John 3, 14. Just as Moses was lifted up, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. And what he's speaking about here, this is Jesus speaking in John 3, 14. He's talking about him being lifted up on the cross and being crucified. He must be lifted up that everyone who believes may have eternal life. So very clearly says that he must be crucified for others to have eternal life. And then it goes on, for God so loved the world, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. But it goes on, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through himself. So whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. I'm moving on. This scripture, that is Luke 23:35-43. This is when Jesus is being crucified, and he has two criminals, two bandits on either side of him being crucified along with him. And it says, the people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, he saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar, poison, and said, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was a written notice above him, which read, this is the king of the Jews. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him, one on one side of him, saying, aren't you the Messiah? This is in his death throes. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and save us. But the other criminal rebuked him and said, don't you fear God? He said, since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he turned to Jesus and said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus answered and said to him, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. From the mouth of Jesus himself. Instantly, he's translated. And one of the things I'm going to read now is the war that's going on in the heavenly. There's a war between kingdoms for the hearts and souls of men. Reading Ephesians 2, 1 to 10. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live. And that is all of us, but I'll go on. In which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following the desires, following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving only of wrath. Because of His, our Father, God the Creator, because of His great mercy, because of His great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our sins, our transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms, that is, in Christ, in order that in the coming ages, and it is coming, and we all know that, in the coming ages, He might show the incomparable riches of His grace expressed in His kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For by grace we have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourselves, it is a gift from God, not by works, because nobody can earn it, nobody can work towards it, so that no one can boast. For we are God's hand, we were created in Christ to do good works. And then again, I said that there are kingdoms at work, at war in the heavenly. And I will read now from Philippians 3:20-21. But our citizenship is in heaven. Christ has already done all the work. And if you believe, as Jesus spoke about, if you call on His name, you will be translated. We are, our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await the Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control, and He is powerful, He is all powerful, who by the power that enables Him to bring everything under His control, will transform our lowly bodies, so that they will be like His glorious body. So now we're seeing that there's a destination. And we speak about Mom, you know, going to a better place. We spoke about Norma going to a better place. It's more than going to a better place. It's becoming an incomparably beautiful being, just like Jesus, as we see here. And there's another reference to that. And this reference is in in 1 Corinthians 15:50-54. And this is what's going to be happening very shortly, if I say so myself. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, the kingdom that I spoke about. Nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep. In other words, we will not all be having died. Some of us will still be alive when this occurs. But definitely, for those who are asleep, there will also be this particular event. I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed, and all being those who follow Christ and follow His commands. We will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkle of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. And looking now quickly at exactly what we will become. In 1 John 3:1-2, very quickly. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. We are God's children. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. If you are too much a friend with the world, you are not God's. That was my statement. Right? The reason the world does not know him, does not know us, is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now that we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been known, has not yet been made known. But we do know this, that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. We shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. And what shall we be like? Let's jump to Revelations. Revelation.
The last one?
This is the last one. Revelation 1:9. I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom, and patient with patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the island of Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. On the Lord's day I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet, which said, write on a scroll what you see. Write on a scroll, with a loud voice like a trumpet. Write on a scroll what you see, and send it to the seven churches in Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me. And when I turned, I saw seven gold lampstands. And among the seven lampstands was someone like a son of man. That was our Christ. And he describes him, dressed in a robe, reaching down to his feet, and with a golden sash around his chest. The hair on his head was white as wool, as white as snow. And his eyes were like a blazing fire. His feet were like bronze in the furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many rushing waters. In his right hand he held seven stars. And coming out of his mouth was a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun. So his eyes was a blazing fire and his face was like the sun. But not just the sun. The sun shining in its most brilliance during the noon. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though I was dead. Couldn't withstand the image, the sight of Christ, the sight of God. Then he placed his right hand, and that is our God. He comes to John and he mercifully places his right hand on him. And he said to me, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death and Hades. And that is our God. That is who we follow. And that is what we are destined for. And that's my speech.
Well, we look at your programs. You see we have readings there. So we will consider that we have had the readings. So that more than what we have listed here. So I will just then say a few brief words, very, very brief. Time is a problem for us. So I just want to just read another passage from the Bible, which is very, very short. And I think it's also quite appropriate in light of everything. I'm reading from the Gospel of Matthew. And it simply says, Matthew chapter 7, from verse 21 to 23. Three verses. It simply says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
But only one who does the will of my Father in heaven. On that day, day of judgment, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And cast out demons in your name, and do many deeds of power in your name, then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoers. So what it says to us, very briefly, 2 minutes, is that really what, as Jesus says, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, and raises his hand or her hand and dances and talks about, you know, Jesus and quotes scripture and so on. Yes, we need to do all these things, eh? Don't get me wrong. But these are externals.
Yeah.
It is the one who does the will of my Father. Yeah. In other words, your life. You shouldn't even, let's face it, we need to talk, I'm not saying no. But we shouldn't have to say, I am a Christian, you know.
True.
People should just look at us and they know.
Yeah.
We shouldn't have to say anything. And so the real proof of what will become of us when the time comes, you know, this is the day of judgment. You're appearing before the great judge and he says, I didn't know you. But he said, I used to preach all about in your name. I used to heal people. You know many things I do in your name? My name? I don't know you. You get away from here. You were looking after yourself. You were bigging up, as we say in Trinidad, you were bigging up yourself. God was not at the center. Everyone who does the will of my Father. What my Father, what you know my Father desires, that's what you must do. And, you know, and that's meaning, it means living it out. And that's really as much as I could say. And as Yvonne is my sister-in-law, I knew her for quite a while, and one thing I might say about her, you might disagree, but I thought she was a very genuine person. I don't think she, like some people say, I don't think she had a bad boy in her body. Maybe not, none of us do really, but you know what I mean. She wasn't the kind to harbor any kinds of, it seemed to me, no kind of hard feelings or so. She was just very open.
Yeah.
You know? And she, I mean, she cared about people. And one of the things that impressed me about her is even after she retired, she was teaching some of these girls, you know, teenage girls, so many of them need that extra education, that example, that nurturing and caring that will help them to find their feet, as it were, because of their start in life, which they didn't have, you know, so they went the wrong way. And that was quite, to me, quite, and in Cocorit and so on, you know. To me, I was quite, you know, it says quite a lot about her compassion and her love. So I think there's much in her life that we could look at and follow. And none of us knows, of course. See, you see this, what I just read there, we don't know. We have to pray that we, that God will be with us, to guide us in the right way, that we too will be open and to self-examination by the guidance of the Holy Spirit, so we will know where we really are.
Yeah.
And so we'll be walking with God's, the help of God's Spirit, walking in the right way. So with these few words, I'd like us now to continue, and we will continue with the prayers for our sister as we pray to God for her and for ourselves. Your answer after I make each petition will be, Lord, hear us. Lord, hear us. For our sister Yvonne, let us pray to the Lord Christ who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Yvonne and dry the tears of all who weep. Lord, hear us. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. Hear us, Lord. You raised the dead to life. Now raise our sister, we pray, to eternal life. Hear us, Lord. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Hear us, Lord. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints. Hear us, Lord. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Hear us, Lord. Comfort us in our sorrow at the death of our sister Yvonne. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Yvonne, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death, and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, and where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. And so we will continue. We didn't sing a hymn. I would like us to, time doesn't allow it, but after the commendation and the committal, we'll at least make sure we sing one hymn. Okay, so I'll now do the commendation and then the committal. It's interesting that today in the church we celebrate the Feast of the Ascension. After his resurrection, as we know, Jesus met his disciples several times and was around. He spent 40 days after his resurrection meeting with his disciples from time to time and so on. And of course, 40 days and 10 days later, that gift that he promised his followers, that universal gift of the Holy Spirit, 10 days from today will be the Feast of Pentecost, which represents that day when the Holy Spirit was universally given to believers. I mean, the Holy Spirit always existed, but in a more selected way in previously. But in our age, God has given his Holy Spirit to all of us.
Yeah.
And so so today is Ascension Day, and in 10 days' time, we remember his ascension, and he's now King, Christ the King. He's been exalted, and we pray that our sister Yvonne will follow. He has opened the way for us, the highway as it were, and believers are able to follow him in that place where he is, seated in the very right hand of the Father and ruling as King at the end of time. So today it's a special day, and it's a day that we commend our sister to her Maker. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant even with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sign but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant, even with your sins, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sign, but life everlasting. And so, let us commend our sister Yvonne to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Yvonne, O Sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set her free from every bond, that she may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend our servant Yvonne. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in life. Amen.
Amen.
Now for the so we continue with the commendation. I'll just as we commend her, the committal, I mean, we'll do it here because I don't know if there's any time when we get there. So let's do the committal, and we'll see. Usually we need some earth, but we don't have earth very much. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not turn away from you. And now for the committal, these are the words we will say. You will say amen at the end of it all. In the sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Yvonne, and we commit her body to the elements, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. And we beseech you, Lord, in your infinite goodness, to give us all grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor. But when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both our sister Yvonne and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for ourselves, all who mourn, Father. We pray for all of us who mourn today at the passing of our sister. Give us peace and courage in the days and weeks and months ahead, so that we will be steadfast and be patient and be consoled. May we not sorrow as those that are hope, because we have a hope. So that we might live the rest of our lives in the joyful expectation of eternal life with our sister and others, loved ones who are born with
us. Amen.
We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
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 Thank you. So, yeah, we're good. Okay, so, mercy eternal, grant to our sister Yvonne, O Lord, and let the light perpetual shine. May she and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. And may the Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and be gracious to her. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon her and give her eternal peace. Amen.
Yes, so.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Amen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us go forth now in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. So we sing that hymn that we haven't had the chance to sing one. Let's just sing What a Friend We Have in Jesus. That's the only one we will be able to sing. It's not too long. And during that time, we will be probably standing up and getting ready to go out one time. So let us, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. All of the trials and temptation, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged.